गुड इवनिंग एवरी वन, आई एम डॉक्टर प्रणव। आई एम अ मेडिसिन रेसिडेंट वर्किंग इन SSKM हॉस्पिटल कोलकाता। एंड इन टूडेज वीडियो आई विल डिस्कस अबाउट द इमर्जिंग फंगल डिजीज म्यूकर माइकोसिस ऑन दिस बैकग्राउंड ऑफ COVID-19 पैंडेमिक। सो इट्स अ मैटर ऑफ कंसर्न फॉर अस दैट अपॉर्चुनिस्टिक पैथोजन लाइक म्यूकर माइकोसिस इज इमर्जिंग इन दिस बैकग्राउंड ऑफ COVID-19 पैंडेमिक विच इज़ ऑलरेडी टेकिंग अ लॉट ऑफ लाइफ इन आवर पेशेंट्स। एंड वी विल ट्राई टू फाइंड आउट the cause of it, the cause of emergence, re-emergence of mucor mycosis, and the effect of this mucor mycosis and probable solution of this disease. So for discussion purpose, I have divided this video into three parts. In first part, there will be a background knowledge regarding the systemic mycosis, and in the second part, there will be its relationship with COVID-19. And in the third part, there will be the possible guidelines the doctor should maintain to prevent and to treat this mucor mycosis along with this COVID-19. So let's move on to the first part of this video, that is the background knowledge regarding the mucor mycosis disease. Okay, moving on to the first part of this video, that is the background knowledge regarding mucor mycosis. It's a systemic mycosis caused by Rhizopus group of septate fungi, but actually a media hype is going on regarding calling the fungus as black fungus. They are mentioning that it is a black fungus because the effect of the fungus on the skin is there will be necrosis of the skin and that leads to blackening of the skin. But black fungus is a separate genus in the fungus family, so we doctors should not use this layman term. And we should not call it black fungus, and we should mention this as mucor mycosis itself, and we should know the spectrum of the disease and pathogenesis of the disease. So mucor mycosis is a commensal pathogen, commensal in our healthy people, because they reside on our skin normally and they do not cause any harm. But in patients who are immunocompromised, they are at risk of developing this disease, because in this patient their immunity is very low, and this causes this commensal pathogen to enter their body and cause invasive systemic fungal disease. So who are the in-risk patients? We should know they are the in-risk patient always, and in this COVID pandemic also they are the most vulnerable target of this fungal disease. So the patients who have already have type 2 diabetes mellitus, they are the most important risk factor of the of this opportunistic pathogen, because they have already impaired immunity due to various causes, as we know in case of diabetes, especially those who are uncontrolled diabetic, and they are on the irregular medication, which is very common in our India. In India, that patients do not follow doctor's advice and they self-prescribe themselves, and they do their harm, and their glycemic status, sugar control becomes very, very irregular and erratic, and therefore they are most vulnerable to this fungal disease. Next, those patients having phagocyte function defect, like those are having neutropenia, or they are those are having glucocorticoid treatment, those patients being treated by steroids in this COVID-19, this is the most important cause of COVID-19. This is the most important cause of emergence of this systemic mycosis. And there is the important factor is elevated levels of free iron, which supports fungal growth. So mucor mycosis is growth is affected by enhanced by siderophore, which are iron containing particle. And if there is increased amount of free iron inside serum, that will increase the possibility of systemic mucor mycosis. As we know that deferoxamine is very commonly used, especially in CKD patients, as iron chelator, and it acts as siderophore and helps in growth of mucor mycosis. So elevated levels of free iron is a independent risk factor for systemic mycosis, mucor mycosis. Okay, any acidosis, like diabetic ketoacidosis, is an important risk factor of COVID in this background, where there is rampant use of steroid, along with the diabetic patients having very poor glycemic control, and they may go into diabetic ketoacidosis. So acidosis itself, along with type 2 diabetes, these are most important to along with glucocorticoid treatment. These are most three important risk factor being evident in this COVID pandemic, where steroid is rampantly used, and other disease having risk of systemic mycosis. Those patients having hematopoietic stem cell transplant, they have a pretty high chance of developing this mucormycosis. And very importantly, those patients having prophylactic antifungal therapy, or those are having already due to any other disease, like any other medical condition, like hematopoietic stem cell transplantation or any other solid organ transplantation, those patients having prophylactic antifungal therapy, they are also at high risk of developing this mucormycosis, because itraconazole and voriconazole, they increases the risk of disseminated mucormycosis. I have put on directly from the Harrison line that patient receiving antifungal prophylaxis with either itraconazole or voriconazole may be at increased risk of mucormycosis. You can see here, and because the voriconazole and itraconazole, they are not effective against this mucormycosis, and they selectively promote the growth of decreases the growth of other fungal pathogens and selectively increases the growth of mucormycosis. So those who are thinking that antifungal prophylaxis like itraconazole, voriconazole or posaconazole, that may increase the patient's susceptibility, that may decrease the susceptibility of getting mucormycosis, they are fully wrong, because in itraconazole or voriconazole prophylaxis, posaconazole or echinocandin prophylaxis, both increases the risk of disseminated mucormycosis as well as risk of breakthrough mucormycosis. So it's very important to note that antiviral prophylaxis is an important factor which increases the possibility of getting mucormycosis rather than decreasing it. So before prescribing anyone a secondary prophylaxis of any antifungal agents like itraconazole, voriconazole or even posaconazole, which are very costly drugs, you should think twice, because they will only increase the risk of mucormycosis. It does not decrease the risk of mucormycosis at all. So you can see direct quote from Harrison also, that these patients typically present with disseminated mucormycosis and most lethal form of the disease, which is the most lethal form of the disease. And breakthrough mucormycosis has also been described in patients receiving posaconazole or echinocandin prophylaxis. So I will tell everyone to be very cautious, because secondary prophylaxis to prevent mucormycosis will be very catastrophic, and we should always prevent ourselves from doing that. And we'll move on to the next part, that is clinical manifestation. So we have to remember that there are five types of mucormycosis. These are the most common type is rhino orbital type, and it is mostly seen in decay patients, and those patients who have developed decay during the treatment of COVID-19 due to steroids or due to infection, those are very vulnerable to develop this rhino orbital cerebral mucormycosis. If you look at the terms, it will explain itself. The rhino means nose, and it's paranasal sinuses, and orbit means eye and surrounding structures, eyeball and surrounding structures, and cerebral means it can extend up to the brain also. So it is the most common form of the disease, and it involves eye, facial, it can involve the nose, PNS, eye, even CNS also. So in this condition, first symptom will be eye, facial pain and numbness. And there may be signs like conjunctival suffusion, bloody vision, fever may be present in as much as 50% cases, but not always. And leukocyte count may be increased or may not be increased. So the disease starts in ethmoid sinus, and then it progresses to the orbit. It's nearby, which is very nearby to this ethmoid sinus. And after that, the patient at this stage may present with proptosis and chemosis. But if you ignore at this stage, the fungus will grow and it will spread to other areas like frontal lobe. It can reach up to frontal lobe of brain and by hematogenous or contiguous route, and it may go to the cavernous sinus also, and by the venous route. And if you find out that the patient had one swelling of one eye, as you can see here, as you can see here, that this unfortunate patient is having mucormycosis, which have so a proptosis along with so chemosis, and the eyeball is protruding out of the orbit, and there is, if you find out that the patient, the disease has also involved the opposite eye, it means that there is involvement of cavernous sinus, because the infection goes to the opposite eye via cavernous sinus, and the fungus may be disseminated from this localized area also, and may cause disseminated fungal infection. So it's a very deadly condition, as you can see to this unfortunate patient, and it has pathophysiology involves two phases. Three phases, like first phase is erythematous phase, when the disease is growing inside the overlying skin, has some erythematous changes, redness over the area, and it may soon progress to edema, local edema, along with this violaceous appearance. You can see here the violet color edema in this patient, and it may later progress to black necrotic scar. From this necrotic eschar like presentation means the disease has already been spread very much, and it indicates poor prognosis. So the colloquial term black fungus has probably came from this type of picture. You can see there is a black necrotic eschar formation of mucormycosis, and underlying this skin, black skin, there will be profuse growth of this mucormycosis fungus, and so the fungus may even protrude from sinus from paranasal sinus to mouth also, as you can see, and produce necrotic ulcer on the heart palate, as you can see here in this patient, unfortunate patient, the white necrotic area is a late finding, and this means the fungal disease has been growing very much inside. And rate of progression is variable in a different condition. It may be very rapid in case of COVID-19. And you can see here in the imaging of this patient, you can see, and there is involvement of the, you can see NCCT PNS and nose has been done. And in this patient, you can see that there is involvement of the right-sided maxillary sinus and ethmoid sinus as well. And there is necrotic material inside. It also mimics other conditions of sinusitis, but you have to be very very cautious about this, especially in this COVID pandemic. Those patients who have got steroid, who have got who had a history of long-standing diabetes, and you should differentiate it from the clinical signs as well as with the help of imaging. And we can see another image of rhino-orbitocerebral mucormycosis, where a 73-year-old male presented with pain in the left side of the face and orbit, and a coronal CT shows soft tissue density involving both the ethmoid sinus. You can see here there is involvement of both the ethmoid sinus and left maxillary sinus. There is involvement of the left maxillary sinus with extension into extracoronal space of the left orbit. There is involvement of the orbit, as you can see in the blue arrow. And axial CT scan shows soft tissue density in the orbital apex, which is shown in the orbital apex in the red arrow. There is showing that orbital apex region, there is fungal growth inside the orbit. So this is the clinical feature and imaging and diagnosis of rhinocerebral orbital mucormycosis. And next we will go to the second type of mucormycosis. That is pulmonary mucormycosis. So it is also a part of systemic mycosis, and it is seen in most commonly in chemotherapy patient and hematopoietic stem cell transplant patients and in leukemia patients. So pulmonary mucormycosis is very common in chemotherapy and hematopoietic stem cell transplantation and leukemia patients. So those patients affected by COVID-19 and got steroid and having these risk factors should also always be then the doctor should always be cautious about his development of pulmonary mucormycosis. It is the second most common form of the disease after rhinocerebral, and the patient presents with dyspnea, cough and chest pain. These are very very similar to the COVID-19 itself, so one must be very much cautious about the disease and development of this disease, and its knowledge that the disease can be seen in after getting steroid, so that one could give a early diagnosis and treat the patient early. So in this pulmonary mucormycosis also, there is no history of, there may not be any history of fever, and usually there is angioinvasion which causes necrosis and cavitation and hemoptysis. The patient may present with hemoptysis as well. So how can you diagnose this pulmonary mucormycosis? We can do a chest X-ray. There will be a lower consolidation, there may be a isolated mass, or there may be a cavity also, and there may be wedge-shaped infarct. So from chest X-ray we can diagnose the patient, and the further imaging should be done by HRCT, which shows the extent of the mucormycosis along with difference from aspergillosis. So differentiating mucormycosis from other systemic other opportunistic infection like aspergillosis is also very important, because COVID-19 related pulmonary aspergillosis is also a growing disease, and it has also been reported, and their treatment is different because the antifungal working in aspergillosis does not work in mucormycosis. So we must differentiate from it from aspergillosis. And more than 10 nodules, pulmonary pleural effusion, and concomitant sinusitis always indicates more common in mucormycosis. So these are the features the possibility of mucormycosis is more than pulmonary aspergillosis, and very critical to diagnose them, because the voriconazole is commonly used in cases of pulmonary aspergillosis, but it is a drug which can exacerbate the mucormycosis infection. So we must be very cautious before diagnosing aspergillosis or mucormycosis radiologically. Next, we'll look into the CT scan of another mucormycosis. As you can see here, this is the cavity. This is the cavitary lesion along with consolidation in this patient's left lung. There is cavitation along with this is the cavitation, and there is you can find its unique pattern, that there is a white halo around this cavitation, and the cavitation is present along with a cavitation inside. So it is called as reverse halo sign. It is very much important sign of mucormycosis, but it is not specific for mucormycosis. So CT scan of chest patient with mucormycosis, and there is destruction of the lung tissue. This is also important to diagnose mucormycosis, as well as it is differentiation from aspergillosis, because this lung destruction is not seen in typically in aspergillosis patient. So we will see another CT scan comparing these two conditions. This is the halo sign. This is the halo sign. You can differentiate it from halo sign, from reverse halo sign. Halo sign is seen in aspergillosis, where there is a nodule surrounded by ground glass opacity. You can see it is seen in aspergillosis, pulmonary invasive aspergillosis, and reverse halo is seen in the mucormycosis, where there is ground glass opacity surrounded by consolidation. This is the ground glass opacity, and this is the consolidation. So this is the reverse halo sign, and destructive lung lesion, these are the important feature of mucormycosis, and these are important points by which you can differentiate it from the aspergillosis, pulmonary aspergillosis. So next we'll move, these are the most important types of the mucormycosis variant. Those are most common in COVID-19 associated mucormycosis also, and there are two another type of mucormycosis also. One is cutaneous. Usually there is trauma and soil exposure with cutaneous implantation of the fungus, and it is highly invasive, it can destroy up to bone, and it may cause necrotizing fasciitis as well. So its treatment is prompt surgical debridement because the prognosis is not that good. And in GI mucormycosis occurs mainly in the premature neonates with disseminated disease with necrotizing enterocolitis. So this is not usually seen in adult population, and the disseminated mucormycosis is the most fatal one of them, and it is seen in ICU admitted patient who are very sick, and they are getting multiple antibiotics and multiple uncontrolled antifungal. They are most prone to develop this disseminated mucormycosis, and most common site of dissemination is brain, and primary site from any primary site like from pulmonary mucormycosis or from rhinocerebral mucormycosis, it may disseminate into brain, and its mortality is quite high. It's almost 96% mortality in cases of disseminated mucormycosis despite treatment. Okay, these are the main types. So we have to remember that the main two types of mucormycosis are the rhinoorbital cerebral and pulmonary type, and these are the most common type in COVID as well. As much as 70 to 80% cases are from in COVID related mucormycosis are rhinocerebral, and as much as 20 to 30% patient of COVID associated mucormycosis are being pulmonary mucormycosis. So now I move on to how to diagnose a suspected case of mucormycosis. So first of all, I must tell that all patients treated with diabetic patient treated with steroids containing even subtle symptoms, we must highly suspect the patient for mucormycosis, because otherwise we cannot diagnose the patient early, and we cannot give early treatment, and which is very necessary to treat the patients. So high suspicion is most necessary part for diagnosis of mucormycosis. And the diagnosis is usually dependent upon biopsy and histopathology, where there is in the histopathology there will be mucormycosis, septa and hyphae can be seen, septated hyphae can be seen. The definitive diagnosis depends on the biopsy and histopathology, but we must not forget that to treat the patient early, we must be dependent upon the imaging techniques. Like MRI brain, and MRI is most sensitive for detecting the rhinoorbital mucormycosis, and it is also very sensitive for cerebral mucormycosis as well. And NCCT comes next, where it can show the bony destruction or involvement of the sinus very easily, and it's a very available test. So NCCT should be done in any cases those are suspected to be mucormycosis. So for every diagnosis of the patient with mucormycosis, we must have a high suspicion index along with and we can diagnose the patient easily with this simple investigations like NCCT, nose, PNS and brain, and we may go to MRI to show the involvement of brain and orbit also. So in the differential diagnosis of the mucormycosis, as I have already told that there is pulmonary aspergillosis is the most important differential diagnosis, both for diagnosis of the patient along with the treatment of the patient, because treatment are not same in case of mucormycosis and aspergillosis. And as I have already shown that mucormycosis, the points in favor of mucormycosis goes in imaging, there will be pleural effusion, there will be destructive lung lesion, and there will be reverse halocyne in case of mucormycosis, while there will be halocyne in cases of aspergillosis. So for as a differential diagnosis, aspergillosis, pulmonary aspergillosis is very important to differentiate from mucormycosis. Next, going to the treatment protocol of this systemic mycosis. There are three important principle of treatment of patient with my mucormycosis. First of all, it's a multidisciplinary teamwork, because we need surgeon, ENT surgeon, we need eye surgeon, and sometimes we need neurosurgeon also if there is involvement of the brain also. And secondly, the treatment should be very aggressive, and because there is a high mortality in these patients, and early treatment is improves the outcome, and it's important to save the patient and to start therapy as early as possible. So first of all, among the antifungal therapy, I will discuss details about antifungal therapy. But most importantly, along with antifungal therapy, we must remember that reversal of underlying risk factor, like I have already told, the diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes, like chemotherapy and iron administration should be these are the risk factor for the mucormycosis. So if as far as possible, this risk factor should be minimized, because like treatment of DKA should be done immediately with sodium bicarbonate. Those have to treat acidosis, and insulin and sodium bicarbonate, and there should be iron administration should be restricted to these suspected patients of mucormycosis, and blood transfusion also should be restricted, and we should stop immunosuppressive therapy if possible. in this patient because it weakens immunity more and there is more risk of disseminated mucormycosis. So number third point is surgical debridement. Where possible, we always debride the where possible and where accessible necrotic mucormycosis tissue is available, we should always try to debride that that part, because the mucormycosis is very infamous to cause blood vessel thrombosis, resulting into tissue necrosis, which leads to poor penetration of antifungal drugs. So you will give drugs, but it will not reach up to the areas where mucormycosis is lying down inside, and it will worsen the disease. So we must always try to debride those areas which are not salvageable. So among the antifungal agents, moving on to the antifungal agents, we should start empirically if there is high clinical suspicion, according to clinician's discretion, because early treatment is the key to success in mucormycosis patient. And if we wait for histopathology, if we wait for the culture to come, we lose the patient. So we must start empirically and once the clinical suspicion is high. And for treatment, there are some antifungal agents. As we know that polyene agents are important antifungal against mucormycosis. The key therapy is given by amphotericin B, which comes in a liposomal, usually in the liposomal format, which is less nephrotoxic and it has a better CNS penetration. And there is amphotericin B lipid complex also, which is also costly, and the dose is 5 to 10 mg/kg for liposomal amphotericin B. And the duration of treatment is usually dependent upon the clinical features, because once the clinical feature start resolving, we can stop the therapy. And the usual duration is 3 to 6 weeks, depending upon the clinical features. So there is a high cost of therapy of amphotericin B, and there are a lot of complications as well. And when you give the patient, there is reaction, there is hypokalemia, there is fever. So the cost is high, as well as the patient has a significant risk of reaction as well, and there is cause of high chance of nephrotoxicity as well. So before so it's a matter of concern that the cost of the therapy as well as the long duration of the therapy. So in the other agents, those are second line agents, and these are isavuconazole, which comes in oral capsule as well as in injection, and posaconazole, which also comes in oral capsule. They are, isavuconazole is preferred in renal impaired patient. In those patient where you cannot give amphotericin B, in those patient posaconazole is preferred. And combination therapy with echinocandins and lipid polyens like amphotericin B has not yet been approved by the FDA, and because there is no still definite evidence of superiority of this combined therapy. After the general concepts about the mucormycosis, now we will discuss about COVID-19 and related mucormycosis, and it has been given new term CAM, or COVID associated mucormycosis. So if we look into the origin first cases of this COVID associated mucormycosis, first case reported was from a case of Italy, and it was a postmortem finding that periodic shift, acid shift, indicating wide irregular accepted ribbon like hyphae. You can see this was a postmortem finding, and soon after that, in December of 2020, first case from India was reported from PGI Chandigarh. And it was case reported in as a coronavirus associated mucormycosis case report and systemic review of literature. And in this case report, it was found, I must discuss the case with you to know how the patient presents with. And it was a case of 55-year-old man with long-standing diabetes mellitus, hypertension, and ischemic cardiomyopathy. He was diagnosed type 2 diabetes mellitus 10 years before the current illness and was on irregular treatment. So these are the important risk factor, the long standing diabetes mellitus along with this irregular treatment and infrequent blood sugar monitoring. And he was also end stage renal disease CKD patient along with maintenance hemodialysis. So during COVID he received he received intravenous dexamethasone 6 mg once a day for 14 days, and he also received remdesivir along with supportive care and venous thromboprophylaxis. So even on the day 21, the patient even on the day 21 of the illness, the patient presented with persistent cough. So the chest X-ray was done. This was the chest X-ray during COVID, where there is bilateral peripheral posterior bilateral peripheral ground glass opacity. And after in the day 24, the ECG and the chest X-ray was done, which showed there is a bilateral infiltrate along with something suspicious lesion in the right side of the lung. So two important factors here. First of all, the symptoms are persistent cough after 21 days, and secondly the important chest X-ray finding, that homogeneous opacity in the right side of the lung in the upper zone, and there this suspicious lung was under investigation, and they suspected a different pathology rather than COVID, post COVID cough, which is very frequently seen. So in CT scan was done, which showed there was the thick walled cavity in the right upper lobe, along with corresponding mediastinal and lung window. So there is a cavitary lesion in which you can see there is a cavity which is surrounded by a halo. So this is the reverse halo sign in this background of post COVID lung. So he was diagnosed as a case of a pulmonary mucormycosis, and amphotericin B treatment was given, and patient remained in ICU for 54 days, and he was the first case back then in December 2020 in India who was cured after 54 days of hospitalization and with amphotericin B treatment, and it was first case reported from India. So in the case second case, a 60-year-old male patient who had also severe breathlessness, pyrexia, tachypnea, and was diagnosed as a COVID-19 case, and he was also a long-standing diabetic for more than 10 years on oral anti-hypoglycemic agents. So he presented with bilateral lead edema with right eye prominence, and noted and topical moxifloxacin was prescribed. On the next day, MRI brain was done, and along with orbit and paranasal sinus, which showed a soft tissue swelling was noted in the right preseptal malar and premaxillary retropalpar regions, which appeared hyperintense on T2 and fluid attenuated flare sequence. So the right extraocular muscles was also bulky, and right proptosis was noted. So this patient eventually, it was the second case of COVID related mucormycosis. This is a rhinoorbital mucormycosis, and you can see here there is involvement of the right side of involvement of the right orbit here and here, and rhinoorbital mucormycosis, and he was also treated with amphotericin B, but unfortunately the patient died before completion of the therapy. So these two cases are reported in the December, but as the second wave came and there was a rampant use of steroid poor glycemic status, as so the patient, the incidence of mucormycosis has since been very incidence has been increased in rapid rate after the second wave of COVID, and currently there is a surge of mucormycosis patients. And nowadays we can see, I have given the newspaper link, in which the newspaper they are falsely reporting as a black fungus. This is not a black fungus. Still, we will there is a epidemic of mucormycosis in India because of this frequent use of steroid and uncontrolled glycemic status of this patient. The opportunistic pathogens are increasing. So what is the cause of this rapid rise of mucormycosis cases? As already been told by Professor Guleria of AIIMS, the misuse of steroid is the chief cause of mucormycosis emergence in India, because chances of fungal infection increase in patients who are diabetic and COVID positive and aren't taking steroids. To prevent this, we must stop misuse of steroid, he said. So now we are in the third part of the video, and the third part is about what should be done by doctors right now. First of all, I must tell that prevention is better than cure, because I have already told that curing treatment of mucormycosis is very costly, and it increases the pressure on health system as well, and so and a huge increased day of hospitalization is required for complete treatment of mucormycosis, and most importantly, the prognosis is very bad. So we must be vigilant about this diagnosis of mucormycosis, and in those patients having increased risk of the disease, and we must prevent the cases rather than treating it. So first of all, first step of prevention is better control of sugar level during COVID-19 with or without steroid. We know that steroid impairs the glycemic status of the patient, so we must be vigilant from the beginning about the dose of the steroid and dose of the insulin to control the hyperglycemia caused by those insulin. So steroid should be next I should tell that steroid should be used judiciously, not by any hurry, and it should be used by observing correct timing, correct dose and correct duration, because if you give in the viremia phase, the steroid will increase the severity of the disease rather than decreasing it. So after 5 to 7 days of symptom onset, the steroid is indicated if the clinical and biochemical parameters are supportive of the therapy, and it should be given in the correct dose. I should tell that the correct dose of steroid in moderate disease is 0.1 to 0.2 mg per kilogram of body weight in moderate disease, and the duration is also important. It should be given for 5 to 10 days. If you give steroid in this dose for 5 to 10 days, there is no need to taper the steroid in a normal patient, and you can stop the steroid without tapering. And so we should always avoid long-term steroid therapy, and after 10 days if we stop the steroid without tapering, that also does not cause any hypothalamic pituitary axis deviation. So home steroid in home without physician's discretion should not be allowed, and even if allowed, there should be always monitoring of the glycemic status of the patient. And we must use antibiotics and antifungals judiciously, because I have already told that an injudicious use of other antifungals like itraconazole and posaconazole and voriconazole, it increases the risk of mucormycosis. So antibiotics and antifungals should be judiciously used, as usually not done in India. It's given in the CDC guideline also that clean sterile humidifier during oxygen therapy is required, because according to the CDC guideline, this mucormycosis can spread via this oxygen humidifier. So they should be poured with clean water rather than infected water. So next, moving on to the early diagnosis of the patient. I have already told that early diagnosis is the cornerstone of the therapy, because early diagnosis by clinical suspicion will cause early treatment of the patient and prevent untimely death of the patient. So we must counsel in the high risk patient, those patients having diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes, CKD, leukemia and hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, so that they report the symptoms early. Sometimes the symptoms are very subtle, and early reporting of the symptoms may save the patient's life, because we have to warn about the symptoms as well during the patient's discharge. Symptoms of rhinocerebral mucormycosis include one-sided facial swelling, headache, nasal or nasal sinus congestion, black lesion on the nasal bridge or upper inside mouth that quickly become more severe, and fever. So these are the features of rhinocerebral mucormycosis. And symptoms of pulmonary mucormycosis include fever, cough, chest pain, shortness of breath. After getting discharged from the hospital, if the patient develops any of these symptoms, physician should be very vigilant about these symptoms, and we must rule out the possibility of mucormycosis in this patient. If suspected, we must always test the patient. Simple chest X-ray may suffice, and it may show a cavitary lesion which increases the risk of mucormycosis. And if there is enough clinical suspicion, we may test the patient with incisivity of nose, PNS and orbit. And MRI orbit and MRI brain is always more sensitive than CT scan. So if there is high clinical suspicion, we must always go to test the patient. And next, I must tell that early treatment with a doctor's discussion is a very important part of the treatment protocol, and antifungal therapy with amphotericin B is may save the patient, and though there is a high mortality, so early diagnosis and treatment is the most important part of the therapy. So there are some myth busters, and these are rumors are getting spread by this unauthorized people that mucormycosis is black fungi. It is not. Black fungi are different in our fungi genus, genera. And secondly, the mucormycosis is not contagious. Unlike COVID-19, it is not a contagious disease. You can keep another patient with a patient who has got mucormycosis. You should not have to isolate the patient because the patient have mucormycosis. So it is, mucormycosis is not contagious. It cannot spread from one person to another. And no antifungal prophylaxis is recommended. Many doctors friends have asked me, should I use this antifungal, that antifungal for antifungal for prophylaxis of the patient? No, that is strict no, because I have already told that itraconazole and voriconazole prophylaxis may increase the risk of mucormycosis rather than decreasing it. So before starting antifungal prophylaxis, you should be knowing about the fact. So take home message from today's video is physicians caring critically ill COVID-19 patients must be aware of serious infection that complicate the course of COVID-19, like mucormycosis is one of them. A high degree of clinical suspicion is required to diagnose pulmonary mucormycosis as well as sinocerebral mucormycosis, and early diagnosis and timely management are necessary to improve the course of mucormycosis. So it is a very enlightening session, and thank you for your patient listening.